many of your names, and some of you I apologize, names slip away. And anyway, I had to chase after Margaret because she had to go back that way. She said, I'm scared, so.
Yeah,
right. She really wasn't scared at all. But anyway, many of you remember that I spoke to you back almost 2 years ago, September of 2018. And I ended my presentation with the announcement. I said, I've met my old friend, and her name is Margaret Carey, and I'm going to marry her. And she used to be called, and still is called, Tinkerbell. And here she is, Margaret Carey.
Wonderful introduction. That is so nice. I like him very, very much. He says, I'm a keeper, and I think he is too.
Yeah.
I'm so happy to be here because he has told me how wonderful you all are, and he's right, and how beautiful the place is, and he's right. And so I get to enjoy what he enjoyed for quite some time. And we thought you might like to know what we are going to tell you. So I'm going to give you a little advance of what we thought we would be able to bring tonight in this time. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my early age of getting into show business. I started when I was 4 years old. And then we get together where we go up to when I'm 18 and I meet one Robert H. Bokey and what goes on there. And then what happened after that. And then I thought I would show you what it's like to be Tinkerbell. What it means, what did I do? How, I mean, that's silly to look at me, and I'm 5'2", and that's too tall to be Tinkerbell. I'll tell you that right now. But it works. So if I may, I shall begin and just tell you briefly that I started in show business, as I say, when I was 4 years old. I was born in 1929, and I caused the Great Depression. You laugh, but everything went right downhill from there. I can't figure out anything else. And unfortunately, my mother died, and I was adopted by, fortunately, two very nice people who were old enough to be my grandparents. And what do you do with, the grandparents said, with a kid who's 4 and a half? You put her to work, because there was Shirley Temple, there were all of the little cute little kids that were running around. And they got me into Central Casting, and I went to work, and one of the first things I did was Midsummer Night's Dream with Olivia de Havilland, and guess what? I played a fairy. And then I went into, maybe you remember Our Gang, sometimes called the New Rascals, and I was in 8 of those, and I learned how to dance, and I became a really good dancer. And I'll move swiftly through. I did about 27 different motion pictures, nothing big, but really just kept working. And as a 4-year-old, back to that, I could make $6.50 a day. Wow. That was a lot it was. Had a wonderful time, very different kind of a childhood, and it was great, I will tell you. Although I had the dearest little annoying mother that you can imagine, because she wanted me to be somebody. That's what she kept saying. Well, I learned later, many years later, that she could play the violin. She wanted to be a concert violinist, but they didn't let a woman up on the stage in 1886.
Wow.
So she never made it, but anyway, she trained me, and my dad was absolutely wonderful. And I'm doing, with all the things that I'm doing television. I had a show on Channel 13 called Teleteam Reporter. I was doing radio. I was doing movies, because that was the time when you tried everything. You know, you didn't know whether television was going to make it or motion pictures were going to make it. It never occurred to anybody that they could both make it. But that was the business in Hollywood. So I grew up there. And by the time that I got to be pretty well established in the business, I did 172 shows, doubled with Charlie Weaver on ABC Network, the first family show that ABC did. I played the daughter. And I did, oh, just a whole bunch of fun stuff, good stuff. And one of the things that I did was I worked with Elizabeth Taylor in the movie National Velvet. Excuse me. And I doubled her on several of the scenes. They put her costume on and her hair, and I did her acting because many, many people don't know that as a child actor, you by law could only work 20 minutes per hour when you were working at the studio, and you could only work 3 hours. The other three, you had to be in school or doing things that children do. So to cover the cost of slowing it down with young people in a movie, they would get somebody to double them. And they could, I was walking away from the camera, or I was waving, or whatever it was. So I did that, that was great fun. I was at MGM for quite some time. And then, I'm 18. And my darling little annoying mother walked into my room, looked at me and said, "You are 18, you may now date." And turned around and walked away. Well, I was going to a girls' school, not a show school for girls, and the reason, one of the main reasons was that I could get a permit to get out to work. So I didn't know any boys. So I said to her, "I don't know any boys." And she said, "Oh, you'll find them." Whoa. Well, I tell you, there was one boy just about that time who did find me. And his name was Robert H. Bokey.
Well, let me tell you how we met. Because it's kind of interesting. Back at that time, TV was just coming onto its own. Well, before it came on its own, really, television screens were about 7 inches high or 7 inches wide. And a few of you were old enough to remember that. But anyway, it was a very small screen. So learning, well, I was in senior in college by this time then, and interested in what I might do for a job. So I was watching this new media television. And lo and behold, I turned on this program. What was it called?
Teleteen Reporter, where we went out and found talent at high schools, and then I was a reporter who supposedly was going to write it up in the high school newspaper, and so they would entertain. Does that sound like shows that we've heard for the last 80 years?
So anyway, I watched this program, and you switched, you know, channels. There weren't very many channels, but I did switch channels, and lo and behold, here was this beautiful gal, and she had a little dance that she did, and she sang a little bit, but the dancing was great, and I thought, well, that's interesting, because TV was really beer ads, and wrestling, and boxing, and beer ads, and wrestling, and beer ads, and then here was Margaret, except that she was known at that time as Peggy Robb. So anyway, I thought, well, maybe TV's got something going for it, so I thought I'd go down to channel 13, which I did in Los Angeles, and introduced myself and said, you know, I'm going to be finished.
Not to me. He didn't introduce himself to me, by the way. He's not that forward, you know.
I'm the shy type. I don't like to put myself forward at all. Mother used to tell me, don't hide behind, you know, get out in front, Bob. And I said, well, I'm afraid to, Mom. But anyway, I went into the station and found the manager, talked with him, and said, I'm graduating, and I've been over in the seas in the service and in the army, and so I'm kind of grown up now. I've had a lot of experiences, but I've been looking for a job, and as you know, jobs are not really easy to come by because all millions of us came back from the war, and now we're on looking for a job and so forth. So I'm looking for a job, and so tell me about TV. And so he said, well, he said, first of all, I don't know where TV's going. He said, if we're just getting started, I don't know if it's going to grow, if it's going to be a big thing. I have no idea what the future is. He said, I could offer you a job because you've got a nice voice, and you look good, and you've got an education. So he said, I could give you a job, but I can't promise you anything beyond giving you a job, and I'm not even sure what you do for us, except you'd be on TV. And I said, well, I'll tell you, one thing you could do for me, I'll think about it, but I would like to know more about that great gal that on the program. So we said, well, he said, she's coming in this afternoon. And he said, I'll introduce you. So lo and behold, a little bit later, here she saunters in.
Looking for boys.
I'm looking for a girl. So anyway, we have a nice little chat in the station. We talk with each other, and I say, well, how about going out to lunch or going out to dinner with me? And she said, well, that would be great. I'd like to do that. And of course, she had just remembered what her mother told her. You're 18 now, so, you know, find some boys. So anyway, we went out. We had some dates and so forth. One of the things that's funny is that there's, some of you have probably been out in Hollywood and know where Rodeo Drive is. Well, Rodeo Drive is where I took her to dinner one night, in a place called the Beverly Tropics. So I've asked Margaret, do you remember our going to dinner at Tinkerbell? And she said, no, I was so overwhelmed by going out, going to such a fancy place, she's forgotten all about the restaurant, famous restaurant at that time on Rodeo Drive. So that was one of the places we went. And then we decided it was time to go to the beach. We thought about going to the beach.
Oh, he kept talking about the beach and the beach and the beach. And that was his life. And I thought, now, I know he knows a lot. He's born in Pasadena. And so he knows a lot about Los Angeles and every place. But I knew of a place that he didn't know. On the beach, he said, that's not true. I know all the beaches. And I said, we're going to go to a place where you never have been before. And it was true. Where did we go to?
And we went to Zuma Beach. And Zuma Beach is north of Santa Monica. Santa Monica is where all the beach people went. That's where they had volleyball outside on the beach and all kinds of fun. Everybody was there. But north of there is this beach called Zuma Beach. And I was used to going to the beach all the time. I'd never heard of Zuma Beach. But anyway, we went to Zuma Beach.
It was great. It was great because I was right.
And guess what? Ever since then, you know, the last, she's been right all the time.
And we had a lovely time and went home. And he invited me to a big party for his fraternity.
Right. Yes.
I was terrified. I had never been close to a college before in my life. I went back to college later on when I was 35, but that was the first time I walked into a college and there were all these people sitting there, and I guess I was polite enough and everything worked out.
Well, the story is kind of interesting because on the way I lived in Pasadena and I picked up Margaret, and on the way to my friend's home who was having a party, he was in Arcadia. So I went down Colorado Avenue and I turned north on whatever street it was, kind of forget now. And I went by a place where you could get a divorce and you could also get a marriage license and so forth. As I went by,
I don't know where he's going with this.
And I went by, I said, oh, by the way, Peggy, because that's what I knew her as at that time. By the way, Peggy, I said, this is where I got my first divorce. I can tell you, I really shocked her, you know, so I laughed and I said, oh, I'm kidding you. So she found out that I didn't always give her a straight line.
No, he never does. But he did give me something that the fraternity was giving every girlfriend that was coming, and it was a bracelet. And it's the sweetest little bracelet that you can imagine, and I kept it. And remember the bracelet later on. Okay.
All right. And then before we parted ways, I graduated from the University of Southern California. And guess who went there at the graduation? But Margaret went there and attended the graduation with me.
And I was terrified. I knew I would use the wrong fork. I knew I would do whatever I was going to do. But he was wonderful. He was just wonderful. Don't worry about it. Everything's fine. And I said, okay, I think I'll go ahead and worry about it. And that's what I did.
So about this time then, I graduated, obviously, and I was then job hunting. And guess what? She was getting phone calls from Disney. Disney wanted her to come in and be interviewed for Tinkerbell. And this was a very exciting for her. This was a big deal. So anyway, she began to get those phone calls, made dates to go in and start the interview process for Tinkerbell. Meanwhile, I got a job. And my job, which was with Mobil Oil, and they said, yeah, we've got to work for us. We'd like you to go work for us. And we want you to move to San Francisco. So that's what happened.
Yes.
I moved to San Francisco out of sight of Margaret, and she started getting her calls, and you take over from here now.
Okay. So it was when I sort of realized that it was happening, I was so completely whirlwind of all the things that were going on, and for television and for Disney, and I will explain that to you in a minute. The next thing that most people want to know is, how did you get the job? Well, by this time, you think that's going to fall over? No. By this time, I had an agent, and I was working at 20th Century Fox on a movie called I'll Get By as an assistant dance director with another assistant dance director who was a friend of mine, Roland Prey, and the overall dance director. And I get this phone call from my agent, can you get off tomorrow? And because they're interviewing for a 3.5-inch sprite who doesn't talk. And I said, well, you know, I really don't want to because we have a big number coming up with June Hager and all of it. Well, they said, it's for Disney. I said, I'll be there at 6 a.m. in the morning. And it was so exciting to go. And I drove up to the gate. It was a very small gate. The Disney studio, as Bob can attest to, is quite small. It's not anything like any of the other big studios. And as a matter of fact, when I worked there, it only had one sound stage. It was just starting to go, to build. So anyway, the man stopped me with my car and said, name, and I gave my name, and he had it on a page, and he could mark it off. I was in seventh heaven. That's all there was to it. So I'll tell you a little bit. I went upstairs to the office of a man whom I just began to idolize. His name is Mark Davis, one of the 9 old men of Disney, one of the greatest artists that Disney has ever had, and the gentlest, kindest man you ever met. And he, I don't know if you saw, excuse me, if you saw Bambi, did you ever see Bambi? Flower and Thumper are his babies that he came up with. And he designed Mrs. Darling, Mr. Darling. He designed Maleficent. I can't go through all of the wonderful things. And then he changed over to designing for the parks. And he designed Pirates of the Caribbean.
Wow.
He designed Haunted Mansion. Just a genius. So I walked in to his office and said, Mr. Davis? And he said, come on in. And I have a picture over there that you can see. There up on the wall was this sketch of this enchanted little fairy. And I didn't want to leave it, but no, sit down. And he was telling me, I told him a little bit about him, and he was telling me what they wanted her to do, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, I thought to myself, well, I can do that. And how I cannot talk, I don't know. that was de rigueur with it. So anyway, I wanted to show you, has anybody ever seen the movie Peter Pan?
Oh yeah.
I think I was. You know, maybe 20 people ever saw it. So anyway, if you remember, there is a nursery scene. And Tinkerbell flies in and lands on a mirror. And she had a big mirror on Wendy's dresser. And she had never seen a mirror before. So they asked me, Mark Davis said, would you do that scene for us? And she likes what she sees, and then suddenly realizes that her hip lips are too large. So I'm going to do that for you. Tuesday. No one had ever asked me if I could come to work next Tuesday. It was always be there. And then he asked, what time? And I, what? 10 o'clock. So I got there, they washed my hair, I wore my one-piece bathing suit. I think I have my book over here that I wrote, Tinker Bell Talk, and in the cover you will see what I wore. And I went in full, the whole sound stage, and I remember this. I stepped out in front of the camera. I knew what Tinkerbell was supposed to do in the scene. And I said, Mr. Davis? That's how long ago it was, you call him Mr. You know? And I said, what do you want her to be? Do you want her to be ditzy like Betty Boo? Do you want her to be above it all, like the Queen of the Fairies? And he very quietly said, Margaret, we want her to be you. So he gave me carte blanche to give her all of her movements, everything, the way that she got angry, all of it in front of the camera. Then they filmed me doing that, and then they would take the second one for protection, and then he would take that and draw from that. He would not, what's the other one? Trace it, but draw, I mean, you would be just astounded at the way that you do. I remember I was standing there one time and he said to me, we want her to be grumpy. And I said, how grumpy? It could be almost anything. So he took a white sheet of paper, I'm not joking, and with a pen, and went on the black and drew the face of Tinkerbell, I would say in about 20, 30 seconds, turned it around to me, and there she was, and she goes. I mean, that to me, working with a genius like that, and Tinkerbell is very, very special and has been very, very special throughout my life, of course, and throughout the lives of many, many, many people. So that's how I got the job, and that's what I did, and I also worked on television at the same time, and I also worked in radio at the same time. Everybody was doing it. And I've forgotten what we go to next.
It's time for the...
All right. You're absolutely right. Thank you, sweetheart. He's older than I am. I remember all these things. Anyway, this lovely lady put this all together. We came in at 11:30 today and handed her these things. And joy, it's just been a joy. That's all I can say.
This is only 6 minutes long, so we won't let you go to sleep right then.
Thank you.
changed my name to Margaret Carey. Here I am with the Three Stooges, and truly, I did 139 episodes with them, but I'm all right. And there I am doing something else crazy. Disney put that all together for me, and I traveled all over to London, to Ireland, to Toronto, to New York, with all of this background so that we could promote Tinkerbell and her love and caring for people. She is really, really magic.
Yes, I can see, right? Yes.
Follow it. Tell them what you're doing.
Well, this is when I was at...
Hold the mic up your mouth.
Oh, yes, right. This is when I was at Omaha Beach, for the 75th anniversary of D-Day. And so this is the cemetery behind the beach at Omaha. And so I paid a visit there, one of the other places. And see, I can't make up... Oh, the other picture is at the presentation, and I'm sitting in the group right behind President Macron. President Trump was there, and there were 36 of us at the ceremony, and it was pretty emotional. I'll put it that way. The first two rows, there were about four rows of soldiers there, and the first two rows, everybody was in a wheelchair, and Everybody had to have somebody with them to help them up and down and so forth. So that was a very emotional experience for me. So that's what this picture was for. This is Omaha Beach again. And there's a picture looking from the stage out towards the audience. And then guess what? I was invited to go on this tour. And we started the tour in Amsterdam. And this is a picture of driving down the street in Amsterdam. And here was this children's store that says Tinkerbell. It's featured on there.
And he'll tell you the story about that in just a few minutes.
Okay.
I don't want him to give it away.
All right.
All right, I think we have some more.
Then we go on to.
Then we're back to little old me. Those are some of those that are over there, and she put those all up today for us. We're trying to get out of the keyhole, and they made it so it took two men to feed me through the keyhole to put the seams.
Okay. And that's you with the little
rascals. Little rascals. And there I am on the Andy Griffith Show, and I invite you all to come up to Mount Airy. We will be up there the third weekend of September, and we will do tribute artists, and Thelma Lou is there, and I've been doing it for about 10 years now. We've had a wonderful time, and working with Andy Griffith was absolutely marvelous, I have said. And there we are. We were at a show where this Disney artist had done a Tinkerbell, and we were raising money for this art gallery that is connected to a college down in Sarasota, the Ringling College of Art and Design.
Right.
So there we were. People always have cameras. And that was his 95th birthday, the day after his 95th birthday. Look at that in August.
That's all I have.
Thank you so much. I thought we would fast forward and 70 years. And but first of all, what were you doing in that 70 years with family and
well, I got started on my job. And I got married, and we started a family. I have four children, and I have six grandchildren. I lost my first wife, married again about 10 or 15 years later. I lost that wife, so I had two wives, and I then was here, as you well know. I was a widower for about 8 years, and then you know what happened then.
And I, during that 7 years, I married the director of the Charlie Ruggles Show. I was married to him after 37 years, had three children, wonderful kids, and I lost him, and then later on, 4 years later, found another gentleman. I was married to him for 12 and a half wonderful years. I was a widow for 20 years. And and then I have grandchildren, and I have gazillions of great grandchildren. And they're all adorable, I will tell you that right now. So that's what happened in that 70 years that we're going to be talking after that he found me. All right? So that we can start in that story.
All right, so then in Amsterdam, my friend said, well, Who's Tinkerbell? I mean, how are you related to Tinkerbell? So I said, well, you can find out by sending her an email us. And he said, well, how do we do that? And I said, well, she's on the internet. So look her up. Her name's Margaret Carey. That's her stage name. She goes by, so look her up. And they looked it up and said, well, here she is. She's been married, and she's a widow now. Has been widowed for quite a while, and so forth and so forth. And my friend said, well, why don't we send her an email and say you're here with us, and we were talking about her, and you wanted to say hi. So I said, well, go ahead and send the email if you want to, but she won't remember me. It's been 70 years, so no chance in the world she'll remember me. But they sent the email, and then?
You got an email back. It said I would be delighted to correspond with Bob Boeke. I remember him very, very well. As a matter of fact, and while I was writing the email, I got up and walked over to my poor dilapidated jewelry box that I've kept for all these decades. And I reached in, and remember I told you about the bracelet that he gave me? That I kept along with my mother's wedding ring. I didn't keep any other, those were the only pieces of jewelry I had in the past. And so I wrote that into the email, and I said, well, let's see. Because you see, I had lived in California for 90 years, and something told me very strong that you're going to move. You're going to leave California. And I would tell my friends all around this, they said, where are you going to go? I said, I haven't a notion. And God will open up a door. Something will happen. It will just be amazing. I must tell you, I like Hallmark television also. I watch the romantic shows. So I sent it back, and lo and behold, I get a call from France. I didn't know it was from France. This man with his wonderful deep voice, almost remember the voice too. He has such a, did you notice what a beautiful voice this man has? It's just, yes. Well, he does, he knows it. So, and you were calling me.
And I called her and said, you know, I thought that we ought to get together. And she said, well, I think that would be a great idea. So I told her where I was, of course, and I've been thinking about her again. And so she said, well, look, I'm going to be up at Mount Airy. Do you know where Mount Airy is in North Carolina? And I said, no, not, I don't really know it. Would know where it is, but I'll look it up on a map. And she said, well, I'll be up there for the
And I had no idea about the East Coast. I had never been here, really, and I didn't know how long it would take to get up in Mount Airy, because he lived, excuse me, he lived here. So I'm thinking, I'm doing shows the whole time. I've never stopped working all my life, doing things for Tinkerbell, going places. It's absolutely wonderful. But I was doing a show for the Andy Griffith Show. We turned Mount Airy into Mayberry Days. He was born there. And Floyd Barber Shop is there. Pork is there. I gotta take a drink. Shut up for a minute, let him go.
So I drove from here, from Hilton Head, up to Mount Airy, and we had talked on the telephone as I was driving up. Pretty long drive from here. Mm-hmm. Took me about 6 or 7 hours to get up there. And I knew that
What did you say first? What did you have to do first?
I'll
see whether I can do it, but I have to have my 94th birthday first.
Yes, I have to have my 94th birthday celebration first. So we did that, and I celebrated it right here, as a matter of fact. So had a great celebration here. So then I drove up there, and I talked to the telephone and said, where are we going to meet? And she said, well, there's a dinner tonight, and it's in the main dining area, the main entertainment area in this hotel. And
I'm sorry, darling. It was in the sports club.
Sports.
Remember, there had been a tournament.
Okay.
And
it was right next to the golf course. That's right.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, so
I bring in golf because golf is, you know, very important.
So I found where it was, and there were people standing outside waiting to go inside, but it wasn't open for them yet. So I said, well, I'm going to go in and see my friend. So I walked in, and the minute I walked in, there, not any farther away than Joy is over there, there was Margaret. And I recognized her immediately. She recognized me.
Yes.
So we went, we got together, I put my arms around her, and the press was there, and the press said, kiss her!
So and he did.
I forced myself to do it. Very reluctant. All right.
So the fun thing was, it was love at first sighting. Second sighting, I mean. And so I'm doing the show. I'm signing autographs for people and chatting with people that I know, talking about the show and talking about the people that I work with on the show. And he said, you know, we have to get together. Let's get together for breakfast. And he picked the Cracker Barrel, right?
I'd like to live it up, you know.
So he went to the Cracker Barrel, and he's telling me, he looks at me and he says, I'm going to have to buy you a house. I said, what? He said, I'm going to have to buy you a house. He said, I think you need a little more excitement than Hilton Head. And I said, what? And he said, but it has to be near a Costco's. I said, why does it have to be near? But he said, I shop at Costco. And so as a joke, I said to him, wait a minute, you're a member of Costco's? He said, yes. I said, you have a Costco card? He said, yes. you let me use it? He said, yes. I said, will you marry me? And he said, well, we'll have to put this all together. And so there it started. And I had about 9 shows set up that I'd already said I would be at, and all over the country. And it took me into the next year, which was 2020, right? And I thought, how am I gonna do this? I'm no good at planning these things or whatever. Ah, maybe we could be married on St. Valentine's Day in the little brown church in the valley in Studio City. That's where Ronald Reagan and Nancy were married and so many people. And it only holds 40 people. I said, we're only going to have 10 people here because all of his family are on the other side and my family is scattered. And it turned out that there were 31 of them and we had room. So he makes all the arrangements to come out, and his kids and their family, they make arrangements to come out. And let's see. The first day that they came, Disney Studios opened up its gates to them, and we took them all over and showed them the whole place and gave them a wonderful tour. We ate that night. The next day, seems to me we got married the next day. Yes, we got married the next day.
Started my downfall.
And that night, he put on a wonderful wedding dinner at Michelli's, and the waiter sang opera to us. Yes, he loves opera, and I like it very, very much. So we had that. The next day, the Disneyana Club, which is a huge fan club, was putting on a big show, and they had asked me to be in the show 6 months before. And it was over at the Smokehouse, which is quite famous, across the street from Warner Brothers. 113 people came, and they met Robert and loved him immediately. And he told some stories, so we finished that. The next day, Walt Disney's barn was open on Griffith Park. That is actually the barn that was on his home in Holy Hills, and where he did all his work and fixing his locomotives and all the rest. And it's open, beautiful garden. 400 people came to meet Robert and see Walt Disney Barn. And the next day he says, come on, we're getting out of here. And he put me on a plane and we flew to Sarasota. before I finish up with what I wanted to say about the end of that flight and getting to the house, because he did buy a house. Are there any questions?
Where's that?
Both of us, you know, have hearing aids, so you have to hold it. No, it doesn't. Oh, yes.
Since you've been married, who does the cooking?
I got a guy who cooks. He loves to cook. I don't cook. I do not cook. Well, that's beside the point. Anyway, I could clean up a mean kitchen. I can tell you that much. Okay.
Nope.
So I've gone through all of this. He's gone through all of this. We've gotten to our flights in time. We have to have a puddle jumper because, you know, nothing comes directly to Sarasota. Comes from Atlanta. We're going through all of this. We're tired, happily tired, and he gets in the car and he drives and drives and drives, and he comes through a gate and he comes up to one of the most beautiful poems you have ever seen. He says, what do you think? And I said, I love it. It's just wonderful. We walk in. Are you ready? This is a woman's dream. It was all furnished. Everything. The kitchen was all furnished. The gathering place. I'm sorry. Yeah. I lost my head. We call it the living room. And we have this beautiful, it's just gorgeous. And then I was going to tell you the topper was that he did the cooking. It's It's a God thing. I really believe that. But I will tell you that Tinkerbell, we're still going on. We're still traveling. Two weeks ago, I got a call from my handlers who said, Ed Asner has dropped out of the celebrity show in Pensacola. He's not feeling well. Can you make it? We gathered everything.
That was Tuesday.
That was Tuesday.
The show started on Thursday.
And he packs 30 times better than I do. It's just wonderful. And we flew to Pensacola, and we did a show Saturday and Sunday. And they treat, now, the best, here's my favorite part of it. While I'm doing the show, having a lovely time, please understand, I just love these people, love Tinkerbell. He's up in the room that we're in with the TV on watching golf.
It was the U.S. Open. Definitely watch that.
And so I guess that's about, oh, he asked me to tell you one thing that I do that he enjoys. Besides all the things that I have done in show business, I've done over 600 cartoons for television. I do voiceover work, I do dialects, and I do about 21 different voices, about 48 different dialects. We don't do dialects anymore, it's a no-no. But anyway, so he asked me if I would do one of the dialect stories for you to give you an idea of how brilliant I am. Now, which dialect would
let's
you
do
like?
Let's do the Irish one.
The Irish, all right. This is an Irish pub that we're at, you know, and they're having a grand time there, and they're talking about diversity, and they're talking about getting back together and making it one country, and it's great being Irish. And the other one says, I don't know whether it's great being Irish. We're all in trouble. He said, well, if you don't take my word for it, let's go ask Paddy. He'll tell us. So they walk over to where Paddy is sitting there, knocking them back pretty good, you know? And they said, Paddy, he says, what is it? He says, what would you be if you weren't Irish? Paddy says, I'd be ashamed. So I guess from my point of view, except thank you, been wonderful. And again, Joy, you are just a joy. That's all I can say.
I have one story to tell them yet.
Oh, that's right, about the magic of Tinkerbell.
Yesterday, we took one of the boat trips out of Harbor Town, and we cruised around outside. And as we sat down in the cruise ship, I was talking to the man on my right and his family, and Margaret was talking with the family on her left. And you tell them about the family.
Grandparents, loving grandparents, with a little tot, and kids were running back and forth, and there was one little boy that was not having a good day. I guess he was about 10.
Yes.
He won. And he turned his back to us and he wouldn't talk to anybody. And he